Now, it is true that some Jews did not believe the promises of God, but also some Jews were unfaithful to their trust. We are the lack of faith, the unfaithfulness, which is preferred one, notify God's faithfulness. Because you ain't faithful. Because you ain't believe. Because you ain't trust. We do not have any effect on God's word. That's the question. You understand? Because the Jews got the word. They got all the commandments. They got all of God's ritual. They got the worship law. They got the tabernacle. They got everything. They got the sacrificial system. They know all things about the law. He said, they got it, but they don't believe it. He said, if by them being entrusted with the word and not believing, does that take away the power of God's word? Does that take away the truth of God's word? Or because they didn't believe it? Or because they didn't follow it? Or because they didn't believe it? That's the question. Alright? So then, do that possibility Paul responded? Not at all. They did not believe. Though some Jews did not believe or were unfaithful, that was by their sinful conduct, God remained what? Faithful to his word.
Make God's
word of Lord Fleck in his personal life. Now, this is what a lot of people get wrong. It messes with you, and you take that for a law, because it didn't work for you. I guarantee that people pray for James just like they pray for Peter. And even though James died, they still pray the same prayer for Peter. And you say to yourself, why? Because God said, you have mercy on whom you will have mercy. And whom he has in your heart. God can do whatever he wants. But they still go to battle. But even though James died, they still didn't stop praying to God for peace. Yeah. And if they don't want that, they don't pray to them. They said, God said, he will be there. He'll do what he said. Now, this is what he will fall to. This is the ice level key. Do you have? He said, unto us was the gospel of preached, and word unto him, yeah, the news, that the word did not profit them. Why? Not being mixed with faith in them that what? Heard. Now, God's word will not profit us unless we mix it with what? Faith. Therefore, the word of God is the faith of God. No longer faith come by hearing God's word. God's word contains his faith. Let's go to Isaiah 55 and 11. So we're going to talk about that. God walks in faith. Everything he says, he believes. You don't have no doubt in it. It may not exist what he's talking about, but he knows what's going to happen. Do you have Isaiah 55 and 11? Says this here. Tell them Psalm 42. Psalm 41. 8th verse. He said, but my thoughts are not your thoughts. See, we got my ways. We got your ways. My ways, says the Lord. He said, we have a heaven to hide the earth. So are my ways hiding your ways, and my thoughts are your thoughts. Now, that lets us know right now that God's thoughts and ways are on a higher level than ours. And we can't even reach that thought. We can't even think about it. All right? He said, we have a heaven and the rain comes down. And it shows in heaven. And it turns back to it. But as long as the earth will make it bring forth and done, then it will give seed to the sun and bread to the ear. God says, what? So shall my word be that bread floweth out of my mouth. He says, what about his word? It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the things whereunto what I say. God's word has God faith. And God's word is God's faith. You see, so the word will not profit anyone who doesn't believe it. But God's word itself doesn't lose any power. Now, when we talk about the word is preached unto them, the gospel is preached unto them, the gospel is preached unto us, we talk about children of Israel. When they came to the land that God promised them, God told them, he said, look, I've given you this land. He said, now go in and possess it. Now, it was not God's idea to send 12 spies. God just conceived and let them send the 12 spies. God said, keep moving. But go in and possess the land that I've given you. They said, we want to see if God's land is over. We want to know if it's all this you're talking about, Moses. That was their idea. That was God told them the land was there. And then the people of God said, they just walked right over there and got the land. But no, they want to see if what Moses said was true. So they said, send 12 spies over there. Well, when the 12 spies went over there, they came back with two reports. Now, the only report they should have came back with was this word, because all that land over there that God said, everything God said over there, and that's a report of faith. But they came back with two reports about it. The Bible said, they came back with this man. Those people over there, they're giants, they got armies over there, they got four. Do you not know everything they said, God knew was there? Yeah. They were always there. But it was there for a purpose. To build your house, to build your well, to plant your vineyard, to do all that was there for you. They was doing all that, getting that land prepared for was using them to bless you. Huh? If God bless you, people not doing that well, when they don't want to do things for themselves, God uses them to bless you. Huh? And they think that they don't have their own God to give their land to the Jews, and they think of this bill and this good house, this good thing, God, this good land, and God can give them somebody else. And then, listen, they had the gospel preached to them. The good news, the best day, flowing with God, they love you. But they got a different report. The thing is, they say, we can't give them a copy of that, man. Now, God has said, I destroy. I move out the way. In fact, let's go to Exodus 23. Let me show you something. We talk about the gospel. You can preach the gospel, the people die. If they don't believe it, won't do no good. Good news is only good news when you receive it. When you don't receive it, it ain't no good news. Okay, now,
they get mad at you, they get upset with you, they don't throw rocks at you because they feel like,
say something like that. I ain't saying nothing but what God said for me. Did you see what God said for them? God said some things that my brother, I claim to myself. I said, brother, if you get from the church to me, man, you can do that for me. All right? Look what it says. If you have numbers. Numbers what? Numbers 13 first. If you don't mix that word of faith, all that the God said, ain't going to come to pass in your life. But if you mix it with faith, you take God at his word, everything that he said happens for that person that believes. What did I say? The Lord will not promise anyone who does not believe it. The God word itself doesn't lose what? Any power because you don't believe it. Alright, now look at the 25th of the 13th chapter of Numbers. Go ahead. Amen. It says here, and they returned from searching of the land, not the 40 days. And then here came the maiden and the land and all kind of these children of Israel. And we are down. And they tell them the 27 brothers, which are in the land, where God sent us as a flood of blood behind him. And then they left. They were saying to them, God, what did that mean? They changed it to our flesh. Yes. Nevertheless, yeah. The people be what? Strong, like the blood of the land. The cities are long and very big. But then we saw the children of Anak there. The Amalekites were running. They're coming down to the third of them. Now, that's words not mixed with faith. They say they God, that the God they made of people who were strong. That God they made of people who had giants in them. That God they made of them wrong. Now look at what Caleb said. This is word mixed with faith. Caleb said this here. In the third of them, and Caleb steal the people from Moses. They said, let us go at once. Once. See, you ain't got no time thinking about what about wondering about. You need to act on God's word. He said, if they didn't hear his voice, harden out your heart. Don't try to figure out how this thing's gonna work. Just step out on what? Faith. He said, let us go at once and possess it. For we are what? Well able to overcome. But the things that went up with him said, we be not well. Able to walk against the people, but they are what? Stronger than we. They brought up an evil report of the land that they searched. He said, God was on that third day of the land, we saw giants, we saw the manna, which comes up giant, and we was in our own sight as well as after. So they knew that God didn't tell them nothing like it. They tried to make the people so strong, and God looked so mean. They tried to make the people so bad, and God looked so chump, that God can't do nothing for them. God told them, I'll put the fear in your heart. Now, go on to the 14th. It says, and all the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, and people got up that night, and all the children were bound against Moses and his hand, and all the people said, we're the God that we've got, died in the land of Egypt, or we're the God that we've died in this wilderness. Let me ask God, brought us up to this land, called by sword, our lives, our children, to be put. We're not better for us in eternity. Now, did God see any of those things? I've seen such a lot of things. Jump that last sequel with all the things God told me to do. Huh? But look at this. This is words not mixed with faith. Look at what it says. It says, when they say it, they say, let us put us in chapter 11, return and eat. They rose in the air, fell in their faces, and all the assembly of the congregation of the children of Israel, and then they were Joshua and Mount and Caleb. And they spoke to all the company of the children of Israel and said, this is very mixed with faith. The land which we passed through to search it is an exceedingly well good land, just like God said. If the Lord delighted us, then he will bring us into this land and give it to us, and the land will flow in the what? Milk and honey. Now look what the people did. They said, only the Lord, not against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land. For they are what?
Bread for us.
Bread for us. Bread is what we said. Is departed from them. And the Lord is what? Is with us. He said, fear them not. But all the congregation went. They cut stones. What stones they cut? In the glory of the Lord of peace. It should be that all they needed was faith. God said, you said your children will be weak for them. And the energy of the children to kill their children. God said, tell children that you said is going to die, they're going to go into the land. And you are going to die in the wilderness. Now, the people that, who took them in? Joshua. They were in the same period of death 40 years later with their 40-year age. Had nothing changed. Their children, who was under 20 years of age, who heard what God said, and probably understand now what was going on, were the ones who walked in there in faith and claimed all those promises. You see, God's promises to who that believe, who put their faith in. He can sit back to the sideline, watch it all go by. So go to the Hebrews game. Show you something. Go ahead and go to the Hebrews. Hebrews 4, yeah.
To be so.
You know what I'm saying? I've got word final authority in our lives. If you don't take this word, this is the source of all truth. And I want to know the definition of truth. When the Bible speaks about truth, truth is the highest form of reality that exists. I mean the highest form. There may be something that's factual, but it's not the highest form of truth. You understand what I'm saying? This is the highest form of truth. It's real. It's, in fact, it's more real than I have ever done. You say, I see yourself, but this is even more truthful than we say over here. That's how I'm going to Paul said. Paul said, let the word of God be true. The word of God alive. I don't think people say that in real life. The word of God is the word of God. And I said, well, that is God's word. It might happen to you, but that is God's word. And he was in the room saying, I know what God said. There are many things you can doubt God on.
It didn't happen for you. But guess what? God's word don't lose no power. People say you can't be saved by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, his death, burial, and resurrection. Well, that's the word of God. If the word of God say that can happen, and a person put his faith in that, guess what? He's saved. In fact, that's the only way that you can be saved. In fact, now, Paul said this here. As it is written, is a quotation from David out of Psalms 51 and 4. David was repentant of his sins. In fact, with Bathsheba and the murder of her husband, Uriah, David was admitting his sinfulness and proclaiming God's complete justification in judging his sin in whatever way he saw fit. David's sin had not made God unholy. It made him unholy. In David's sinfulness, he now saw the holiness of God more clearly than ever. This is what Paul is drawing from this Old Testament passage. He was saying that in a similar manner, God retains his holiness even when his people were unholy. It was the Jews who suffered for not believing God's word, not God. How many times have you said, if I had just listened to God? Huh? How many times? If I had just went on and believed and trust God? Huh? How many times? And another thing, when you do trust God and things do come through, guess what? You get a more encouragement to your faith. You begin to see God in people, huh? And then when you don't follow God's word, you look around and you see somebody else getting blessed. And hey, you around here losing all your joy, losing all your peace because you don't want to believe and they believed. And God blessed them. And you sitting around in your same predicament, ain't got out of that hole, ain't got out of that trouble, ain't got out of that loop around your neck, huh? You still bound, you still can't set yourself free, all because of what? You don't want to believe what the word of God says. And see, I'm going to tell you something. I could have stayed bound, locked up, tied up, running from tomb to tomb, butt naked just like a crazy maniac. But guess what? I knew something that was true. And if I could just reach it, I know I could be delivered. You think that man ran to Jesus not knowing who Jesus was and what Jesus could do for him? He knew that the priest couldn't do it. He knew that the chains couldn't do it. He knew that the psychiatrist couldn't do it. But when he saw Jesus, the Bible says he came running to who? To Jesus. What you come running to Jesus for? Because he knows Jesus got the power to make a difference in his life. And see, he believed that he come running down there. And Jesus said, get out of him. Y'all come, let him go. Get somewhere to go. They said, God, give us another home, please. We know we got to go because you done told us to leave. Because see, well, I'm going to tell you something. When God's word goes out, he said, it's not coming back to me for. He said, come out of that man. And when he spoke those words, those demons knew that they was evacuated. They knew that they had to go. They knew that they didn't have nowhere else to stay. And so they said, Lord, please give us a place to stay. God gave them some what? Some pigs. And the pigs said, you can't live in here. Pigs said, we're going to kill ourselves for we allow y'all to stay here. But you see, the thing is this here. You won't come out of the mess you in until you start believing what God's word says. You understand? David saw God's word so clear. After he committed that sin and David's sinfulness, he now saw, thank you, he now saw the holiness of God more clearly than ever. And I hear that so many times from people who fallen into sin, people who made mistakes, people who fell down. Brother, they now understand. Man, going back out there in that world ain't all what you think. You better stay with God. The devil fool you, make you think that, oh, you don't need to be in church. You need to be out there in the world. You need to be back there doing what I'm saying. And when you get back out there, you find out ain't nothing like that. Do you realize how you be just like the prodigal son? You realize, good gracious, how good it was in my father's house. Huh? They had plenty and some to spare. And yet here I am, what? Starving. Huh? See, the devil make it seem like it's out there where all action is, but I'm telling you, all action is in the house of the Lord, huh? And this is what Paul is drawing from this Old Testament passage. He was saying that in a similar manner, God retains his holiness even when his peoples were unholy. It was the Jews who suffered for not believing God's word and not God. Therefore, when you consider how unfaithful we have been to God, it makes God's mercy and his faithfulness appear even greater. So now, this brings up two new questions, huh? You see, he really wants you to see that your actions has nothing to do with God's word, huh? God's word works outside of whatever you do, huh? You see, they thought when they threw Joseph in the hole, they were going to stop God's word, huh? We're gonna see what become of this dreamer, they said. Well, you couldn't stop God's word, huh? They thinking that they're going to stop. People think they're going to stop God's word from working in your life by doing certain things to you. You can't stop God's word. Huh? That word is too what? Powerful. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. Look at verses 5 and 6. It says this here. It says, but if our unrighteousness commend the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unrighteous who taketh vengeance? I speak as a man. God forbid. Then how shall God judge the world? The first is, what shall we say to the idea that the Jews' unrighteousness served to emphasize God's righteousness? Could they not conclude that God's wrath on Jews is therefore unjust? Put another way, if my unrighteousness reveals God's righteousness or causes it to be seen in an even greater way, then am I not actually helping God? Would it be right for God to judge me for something like that? Paul immediately interjects, I am using a human argument, and responded with the answer, God forbid, or what? Certainly not. Paul is saying the logic he had just been using was not from God, but was carnal when he's speaking as a man. He said, if that was the case, he said, God was unfair in judging unfaithful Jews, then he would be barred from judging the world. And of course, that could not be. It is a well-established fact in the scripture that God will judge the world. So since God will judge the world, he will not be unfair in extending his wrath on what? On the guilty Jews. To say that God is unfair in condemning sin is to blaspheme the very nature of God. Such people who question God condemning are therefore themselves condemned. It is true that man would never have seen the love and the goodness of God as clearly if we had not sinned. But that does not mean our sins was a good thing. This is one piece of information that the Lord never wanted us to know by experience. No one will be able to tell God on judgment day that his sin just helped God reveal how great his mercy was. The Lord would be totally just in bringing judgment on those who refuse the offer of mercy given through Jesus, his son. Somebody say, well, you got to have sinners. Without us, y'all ain't got nobody to go revive. Y'all ain't got nobody to go witness to. So you got to have sinners. And you think because he's a sinner, God going to save you for that. God don't need no sinner to save. Huh? God didn't never want us to be in sin. It was never God's intention for us to be in sin. But if you want to, God gives us that free choice. And don't think that you're helping God out because you're not doing the things God wants you to do. And you say, well, I can show the love of God. I can show the mercy of God. That's crazy. The thing is this here. I can see the love of God in righteousness. Adam could have seen the love of God without eating from that tree. All the things, I mean, come on, man, good gracious, the man had everything in the world, plus God every evening, all right? He could have seen the love of God without that, but he really saw the love of God. You know why he saw it? Because he was kicked out of the garden. And when you kicked out of that, you see all what you missed, all what you could have had, then you can see, oh, man, God really did what? Love me. When the devil comes in and begin to do things to you, you begin to see. And the thing is, God don't want to reveal himself that way to you. You understand what I'm saying? God don't want you to know he's merciful by you going doing things that you ain't got no business doing. God don't want you to know that he's a forgiving God. But that never was God's. God, you know, there are some things my mother and father never wanted me to experience. And I'm sure that's something you say to your children, you hope that they never experience. Some of the things that you've done in life, you say, I hope to God y'all don't never experience that. It's because some of them say, I want to be just like my daddy. My daddy was a drunk. My daddy was a bully. My daddy chopped people and stabbed people. And some kids, they take that and they do that. But their father would say, no, son, don't follow that route. Stay out of that path. I tell you all what kind of trouble. You might lose your life at a young age. You understand? But they thinking they being just like you. And see, the thing is this here. Paul said this here. He don't want you to experience all these bad things. Even though we know our God is a loving God, even though our God is a merciful God, even though our God is a good God, huh? But God don't want you to go sin. David found out just how just God was. He knew he was supposed to die. He knew he was supposed to be where that baby was, huh? See, I'm going to tell you something. Somebody got to pay the price, huh? David should have been the one getting sick and dying. But God said, no, I'll take that child. Huh? David getting down on his knees, praying to God, saying, God, please, please, try to save the child's life, spare the child's life. Huh? And God still took the child's life. But he should have took whose life? He should have took David's life. Huh? And David said, whatever God's doing, he's just in doing it. Because I know I don't deserve no mercy. I know I don't deserve no pardon. I'm dead guilty. He knew he was. But you see, it took Nathan coming to him and telling him a story. And Nathan pointing at him and saying, now he could have, guess what? He could have repented because Nathan came about almost a year later. But the fact of the matter, God gave him all that time to repent. And he wouldn't do it. And then even after God condemned him, he still sat up there and said, boy, look here. I know you just. you fair. Everybody who walk around, because see, people don't think God's fair. They don't know how good he is. They can't see it. But David knew when he should have died. And God spared his life. He said, boy, ooh, God just. when the judge should have sentenced you to the electric chair and he set you free, he said, whoa. That just. That just fair. Bro, because when it favors you, you really understand, huh? You don't. Sometimes, like I say, some of the things I've gone through in life, I wish I had took another road. I wish I had made another decision. I would have been so much further along in my life. But I learned from those things, huh? I found out, thankful to the Lord, huh? God got me back on the right track. You understand? But God don't intend for you to go that way. God intend for you to stay in the right path. Look at verse 7 and 8, because we can get time getting fast out of it. It says, for if the truth of God has more bound through my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner? And not rather as we be slanders reported, and as some affirm we say, let us do evil, that good become, whose damnation is what? Just. The second question is this. If someone's lack of truth enhances God's truthfulness, how can God in fairness condemn or judge him as a sinner? In other words, since sin seemingly benefits God, How could he turn around and judge sinners for their sin? Paul raised these two questions, which are examples of unsaved people's misleading and false reasoning, because some opponents were falsely accusing him of advancing them and proclaiming, "Let us do evil things that good things may result." You know, some people think that when you preach the grace of God, that you're preaching an easy believing, easy living life. You are letting people get away with everything. You tell it, you know, I know people get mad when I say this, and some people don't agree with this. I say, once saved, always saved. Now, if you understood what I said, you understood what I mean. But a lot of people, they don't understand what I said. They say, "Oh, I done seen saved people do this." I say, if you save, you got the first beat thing, you got to get that right. If you save, and according to everything I read about salvation, you're going to always be saved. But now, if you ain't saved, and a lot of people take what people do and what people say and how people act, and they draw a conclusion and say, you can't make that statement. Oh, I can make that statement. Because they say, I'm sealed until the day of redemption. The moment the Holy Spirit comes into my life, it seals me. And that seal lasts until he comes back and gets me and takes me back with him. Now, unless God's word lied, the Holy Ghost, according to the scripture, is a guarantee that I'm saved. All right? Now, people say, well, how you going to do that? They go to their grave wondering whether or not they're going to be saved. You see? But the thing is this here. God said, he'll keep me from falling. He said, he'll present me faultless before the presence of his glory. And then he said, he's going to do it with exceeding joy. Huh? Now, he said that. I ain't no way in the world. Long I can do it, everything I can act, try, do, won't get me blameless, won't get me faultless, won't get me pure. I'll never be able to do it. He has to what? Do that. You see, these are the promises of God. These are the commandments of God that God said, if you obey and you do these things, this is what I will do for you. The devil will fear you. He'll run from you. His demons will be scared of you. You'll have power over the enemy. You'll have power over sickness. You'll have power over the grave. Brother, look here. All this because what? I believe in his promise. You know what's so crazy about people? You ask those people. They say, do you believe you're going to heaven? Well, I hope so. That's so crazy. Either you're going or you ain't. Well, I hope so. Well, what's going to get you there? Well, I'm trying to get some things right. Oh, my goodness. Because every time you get one thing right, something else get it wrong. You understand? Or something else come up. You understand? But if Jesus get it right, that's right, and it's over with. And then he getting you something else right. You understand? The Bible says we got to put this off, then we got to put this on. Everything that you take off, if you don't put this on, that you took off come back. You understand? But if you took it off, it's coming back. But if God took it off, it's through. It's over with. A lot of times in Jesus healing people and Jesus casting out demons, Jesus will say, leave and don't come back. You know what that demon knew? That was it with that person. I'm through. Because he said, leave him and don't you come back. And brother, look here. That demon body, if he was in Georgia, when Jesus said don't come back, I bet you he was in France or London. He coming back. He coming back to the United States. Huh? But now, the apostle did not reply to these slanders. He assigned such people to God and simply observe their condemnation, judgment is deserved. Paul preached the grace of God as no one else recorded in the scripture. This led many people to slander him and his teaching by accusing him of encouraging people to sin. This was totally untrue. The grace of God teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. Paul shows his total rejection of those allegations by saying that the damnation of those people is just. He also raises the stakes for anyone who wants to criticize those who proclaim the grace of God. According to Paul, they will be damned. You see, some people think you got to put a rope, a line, handcuffs, shackles to keep a person straight. You can put all that on him, and you still won't keep him straight. If the Holy Ghost don't get you clean, nobody can clean you. If the Holy Ghost don't live the life of Christ through you, you can't live it. Huh? It's all done by God. You see, folks trying to say, because if I keep them in church 7 days a week, then I keep them out of them streets. I guarantee you, if they want to get out of them streets, they'll come to your church 7 nights, and after they get out of church, they'll go to the bar. That won't stop them. If their hearts are not circumcised, if they haven't had a spiritual work done on their inside, whatever they're showing you on the outside ain't going to cover it. Because God said you got to circumcise that heart in order to change that life. And if you don't circumcise that heart, that life ain't going to change. It's going to be the what? The same thing. And that's what the Holy Spirit comes to do. It comes to clean us up, get rid of all that old stuff, put all that new stuff in. This life is so easy. That's why I wonder why people are talking about. You know, you do have some hard days, but it's a lot easier with the Holy Ghost. Huh? You can go through it a lot better knowing that God is on your side. But the promises of God and the commandments of God, if it ain't mixed with faith, it won't happen for you. It won't work for you. It only works by faith. So we thank God. Let us stand at this time. Lift our hands towards heaven. Is it now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Let all the peoples of God say, amen. Shake somebody's hand and say, Jesus loves you.